Penguin Random House Audio presents The Scientist and the Spy, a true story of China, the FBI, and industrial espionage by Mara Hvistendahl. Read for you by James Lurie with Mara Hvistendahl.
For Axel.
Once, when all the maize was planted, Hiawatha, wise and thoughtful, spake and said to Minnehaha, to his wife, the Laughing Water, "You shall bless tonight the cornfields, draw a magic circle round them, to protect them from destruction, blast of mildew, blight of insect, Wagaman, the thief of cornfields, Pimocide, who steals the maize ear." Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, Part 13, Blessing the Cornfields, The Song of Hiawatha. 1. Fall, 2011. Deputy Cass Bowman sped toward the farm, the bright morning sun glaring through the window of his patrol car. To the north was the town of Bondurant, Iowa, where newly built houses huddled together on treeless lots, churches dominated street corners, and the marquee outside Dino's storage read, "Avoid all negative talk." To the south was a Tetris puzzle of cornfields, God-fearing citizens on one side, vast fields on the other, and two-lane 70th Avenue running like a ruler between the two. A few miles east of town, Bowman steered the patrol car toward the corn. The fields were a few weeks from harvest, and the corn stretched over 7 feet tall. Central Iowa had blossomed into the lingering, pleasant days that make its winter hibernation bearable. Just a few minutes earlier, Bowman had been about to take a coffee break at the get-and-go when an alert came over the radio for an incident out by 96th Street. "South of here, walking westbound, there is an Asian male wearing a suit walking through a farm field. He was dropped off. Nature of incident? Suspicious." 18 years in the Polk County Sheriff's Office had taught Bowman to suspend judgment. Bondurant was a sleepy place, its dramas centered on grass clippings left in the street and holes dug in lawns by stray farm cats. But still, Bowman saw his share of action. The area he patrolled included the outskirts of Des Moines, and in addition to making traffic stops, he had worked murders and negotiated for hostages. Once, he pursued a meth-fueled driver in a car chase that ended with the driver's girlfriend being flung to her death in a grisly crash. Best-case scenario, he thought, the man in the field was simply an unusually well-dressed farm worker whom a neighbor had mistaken for an intruder. Worst-case scenario, the man was burying a body. Bowman slowed the patrol car to a stop in a grassy clearing alongside a drainage ditch. About 100 yards into the field was a thin, neatly dressed man. In the distance, row upon row of stalks lined up like infantry. The corn between the man and the road had been cleared, allowing Bowman a direct line of sight. To his left was a cheery stucco dwelling with a broad veranda and a white picket fence encircling a pasture for grazing horses. Two other deputies arrived around the same time and were on their way out to talk to the man, so Bowman walked over to the house to chat with the farmer who owned the land. The farmer worked this land with his brother, planting part of it for their own use and part of it under contract with Monsanto. He told Bowman that he'd been out doing his morning rounds when he spotted the unfamiliar man walking on the Monsanto plot. The corn the farmer grew for Monsanto was genetically modified inbred seed that the company used to produce commercial hybrids, which were sold at great profit to farmers for the next year's planting and eventually turned into food or fuel, perhaps Doritos, perhaps ethanol. The seeds had been spliced with genes that made them resistant to certain pesticides, most likely the Monsanto weed killer Roundup. allowing the farmers who eventually purchase the commercial offspring to freely spray for weeds or insects without killing their crop. The company considered them valuable intellectual property. Monsanto kept the locations of such contract plots secret and enforced this secrecy through aggressive lawsuits. Unlike the fields where farmers grew commercial corn, which sported small guideposts that doubled as advertisements for seed lines, Pioneer 3394, DeKalb 6255, the Monsanto plot was unmarked. Even the farmer himself knew little about the seed growing on his land. For part of the season, that was sufficient protection. Only locals who watched the Monsanto truck arrive to measure growth or spray pesticides knew that certain fields grew proprietary inbred seeds. The inbred seeds were planted in a pattern, with one or two rows of seeds designated as males for every 4 to 6 rows of females. Then, in midsummer, as the commercial corn in the surrounding fields stood tall, Monsanto sent in machines to detassel the female rows of corn, shearing off their yellow, pollen-laden crowns in a mass spaying, leaving only the male plants intact. Soon after, the males fertilized the females, and then the company mowed down the male rows of corn. The field now looked like a buzz cut with lines shaved into it, making it easy for outsiders to identify. And the man looked like an outsider. It was his face that the farmer had noticed first. The man had angular features, with a broad forehead framed by a receding flop of black hair. But more important was the way those features combined in the farmer's mind to cancel out other details. Bondurant, population 3,860, is 97% white. The man was not. The man walked with his head down, the farmer reported, as if he were scanning the ground. After considering the man's race, the farmer thought about his clothes. Khakis, dress shoes, a short-sleeved collared shirt. And he'd been dropped off by a gray SUV, which had then driven away. Why the hell did the car leave? The farmer knew that after the detasseling process, a few stray inbred ears, what in the industry were called escapes, often lingered on the ground. Thinking that something suspicious might be at hand, he called his wife, who worked as a police officer one town over, and she called Polk County Dispatch, which sent out the alert that blared over Bowman's radio. At some point in this telephone chain, the stranger's business casual outfit became a suit, and his race became his defining attribute. As Bowman and the farmer stood outside the farmhouse talking, the gray SUV the farmer had seen dropping the man off zoomed past. "Well," the farmer said, "there it is." The other deputies were still talking with the man in the field, so Bowman got back behind the wheel of his patrol car and sped off to pursue the SUV. Flicking on his lights, he soon fell in behind the vehicle. He could see the backs of two heads. The lights worked. A quarter mile or so from the house, the SUV pulled over to the side of the road. The two men remained still as Bowman approached the driver's window. Bowman asked the men for identification. The driver was Robert Moe, a man identified on his license as Hai Lung Moe. He was 42 and lived in Boca Raton, Florida. His head was shaved, and he had broad cheeks that tapered to an undefined jaw. His companion was an older man with taut lips that shifted into a nervous grin. He was identified on his Chinese passport as Li Xiaoming. The man from the field was named Wang Lei. Robert Mo did the talking, and he was utterly polite. He explained that his two companions were visiting from China, where they researched agronomy. The men were driving across the Midwest looking at crops. That they would come to Iowa made sense. Corn was big business, both for the state and for the world. Corn is in the animal feed that fattens cows and chickens, and in the high fructose corn syrup that sweetens ketchup, soda, and salad dressing. Over 90% of the starch and 56% of the sweeteners in the American diet come from corn. 56 is also the percentage of a McDonald's chicken nugget that is corn. For many years, the fungus that produces penicillin was grown in a corn byproduct, and many cosmetics contain corn. Altogether, the crop covers 93 million acres in the United States, a swath nearly the size of California. And Iowa, which produces more corn than any other state, is the center of the industry. Bowman wondered, though, how much could you actually learn by just looking at a field? To Robert Moe, he said, "Have you been up to Iowa State and talked to them at the university?" It was a fair question. Iowa State was a big land-grant university with a strong agriculture.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.